Everybody, my name's Aaron Ciotti. Most people call me Ciotti, and I am now gainfully unemployed. I got laid off yesterday morning. I woke up, logged in remotely. I worked remote for a company called Benefit Focus, who's in the healthcare world, so I thought I was pretty safe. But apparently I wasn't. And yeah, they let go of 250 people out of a 300 person company. So at least I was in the 50%, I guess. So yeah, now what? Any ideas? yeah, we'll see what happens. I've been there for a number of years, so I did get a little bit of a severance package, 1 month of pay and 1 month of benefits, which starts tomorrow? When's May 1st? Friday. So that starts Friday, and yeah, we'll see. We'll see what happens. I'll do the unemployment thing, and we'll see what happens. This is the third time in my career in the last, I don't know, what age do you start working? 16, 17? I'm 39 now, and this is the third time that I've not been the one to choose to stop working at a company. And it sucks. It's no easier the third time than it was the second or the first. I could have worked harder to try to protect myself more, right? I could have done a lot of things, but I didn't, and this is where we're at. Who knows if, I mean, laying off half your workforce, the company might not be around too much longer, so, you know, maybe it wouldn't have made a difference, but here we are. A new adventure begins, which is been a common theme in my wife and my lives in the over the last like 9 years. 6 or 7 years ago, we just packed everything up in New Jersey, left everybody that we ever knew, and moved to Charleston where we didn't know anybody. I just signed our lease renewal. So a year ago we did it again, and we came here to Alpharetta, right by Atlanta. And yeah, it's scary, man. Big life changes like that are very scary. But the big changes are the good ones, right? Like, if it was easy, everybody would do it, kind of thing. The big life changes have been the hardest and the scariest, but they've always netted the most interesting results. Sometimes good, sometimes bad, but definitely interesting, and this one will potentially be no different. More than likely be no different. So we'll see where it takes me. You guys, so this time it's a little different in that I've got a lot of you, I've got a support system in you guys, supporting me on Patreon and here on YouTube, and that's very different. That's not something I'm used to at all. So I gotta kind of wrap my head around that. I am very tempted to try to turn this into a thing. I am going to try to stream every single day. Just if nothing else, to hang out with you guys. It really does wonders for my mental health to just hang out with you guys and just have this feeling of a really amazing, great group of friends that you guys are, and supporters, and although I really consider you guys friends more than supporters, but you're definitely supporters as well, obviously. But I don't know. We'll see. I never. My thought process up until this point has been work your day job. There was. I went to school for communications, and really good state school, called the College of New Jersey, up in New Jersey. And I have a bachelor's in communications from there, which and then that kind of got me into sales. And after a bunch of years of sales, that led to project management. And project management has kind of been a blast ever since. Like, it's sure, it's a day job, right? It's a 9 to 5, which sucks, sort of. But yeah, it's a job. It's a career job, right? Like, I've got the better part of 20 years into this career, and it pays well. Well, most project management jobs pay well. You can typically make anywhere from 60 to 100 a year, as a project manager. And this company that I was with, out of Charleston, I was not making that. I was below that range, which is pretty unusual. Not for Charleston though. Charleston is a very it's a great place to visit, but a very tough place to live. The wages are just low across the board. More than likely because it's a tourist town and it's like this hot spot right now for kids moving down from the north. A lot of folks from New Jersey, a lot of folks from Ohio are moving there. So a lot of the businesses in Charleston have decided to just really chop all of their salaries down to nothing and just rely on the fact that they get tons and tons and tons of applicants, so they can just pay nothing and get somebody to get a body in the seat, and then maybe they're good, maybe they're not. Typically they're not, in my experience of living there for 5 years and change. But yeah, so I mean that was a big part of the move to here in Alpharetta was we Kristen and I basically looked for the closest spot that we could. I mean, technically the closest spot that we could have done this was Charlotte, but we visited Charlotte. We visited here. We liked it better here. But yeah, that was a big reason that we moved here was so that I could leave that job. I worked remotely for it was supposed to be just a little while, just to kind of pay the bills so that we had solid income, and then I was gonna start looking for work, local work here. All the shit went down with the Miata, and that delayed it, because I didn't have a car to go to work. I wasn't the plan wasn't to look for remote work. The plan was to look for brick and mortar work here. And without a car, that was very difficult, stroke impossible. So yeah, a lot of delays, and then of course the virus just continued that. It's my own fault. I should have been applying to positions from a year ago and just figured it out. But I didn't, And that's okay. I made decisions. I was lazy. I didn't have to turn to it didn't go that bad, right? Like, I'm still alive. I still have a face. It hasn't been cut off or anything. I don't know. I don't know, guys. It's so yeah. Push a definite push for me to find something here, local. Terrible timing, of course, because of the virus, and it's arguably the worst time to be looking for work right now. Unemployment is higher than I think it's ever been in the US. So maybe since like the Depression, I guess. But I'll do what I have to do. I filled out the all the bullshit for my job, the separation paperwork, all that nonsense today. Tomorrow or tonight, I will do the unemployment thing. And I'm gonna start streaming every day, like I said, so you guys will see more of me than than I'm sure you want. And yeah, I'll start looking for remote work. I don't do super well working remote. There's an awful lot of distractions around here. But the freedom from working remote is pretty gnarly, and it allows me to get FPV stuff done during the day and get like posts put up and schedule these streams out and some other stuff that's kind of nice. So the remote working thing definitely has its benefits. So I and especially with what's going with the virus, the only jobs that are really going to be hiring for a project manager are going to be remote. So yeah, I'll that kind of opens up, I can work. I don't just have to apply to jobs that are within a 15, 20-mile radius, right? I can apply to jobs in fucking Bangalore if I really want to. So that'll be interesting. I've never done that before. I've never applied for work outside of my little immediate area. So we'll see how it goes. If any of you guys know of jobs hiring for project managers remote, definitely let me know. Other than that, let's see if this FPV shit can become a thing. What do you say? I'll give it a go. I've been streaming twice a week, and we're at 120 patrons. What if I stream 7 times a week? Is that going to put us to 300? If we can get to 300 patrons, I can probably just do this. I think 400 is going to be a little bit more realistic. I think basically at 300 patrons, I can afford to live, but I won't have health insurance. I think if we get to 400, I can also have health insurance, which is becoming more and more important as I age and as a virus tries to kill all of us, right? So we'll see, man. Let's fuck it, right? Let's do it. Let's build quads. Let's sim. Let's do editing streams. Let's see what happens. So fuck the pity party. We're just gonna go. I'm just gonna go like this, put my head down, and just start charging forward, man. And I hope you guys come along with me for the ride, 'cause it's gonna be crazy. I have no idea what's gonna happen. I know I'm kind of preaching to the choir, and a lot of you folks are also on furlough or out of work. So yeah, I appreciate the kind words thus far in the chat. Speaking of the chat, let's fucking get into it. No more pity party. Who's in the chat? Looks like this participants thing doesn't work all that well. Big Willy FPV, Cement Kid, Dogmouth, EBR FPV, Esk Race, Jakina Backpack, Mondo FPV, OCD FPV, Pedro Tome, Pesky FPV, Pile of Carbon, Rob Axelson, Sterling Youngman, and Steve O43068. What's up, everybody? I know I missed people. YouTube's little participant list thing here doesn't work all that well. Let's start going through the chat, man. Dark Sagan says, "Sorry to hear the bad news. Keep your head up. Hopefully, this shit will be over soon." Agreed. Peak FPV, dude. I hope you take some time to remind yourself how valuable you are to all of us. I might be valuable, but apparently I can't speak worth a shit. Thank you for that, Pesky. That means a lot, and that's so in my journey through mental illness, depression, anxiety, what tends to happen for me is I'll get into a really bad place. I won't be able to dig myself out for 6 months, a year, and I'll finally say, all right, screw it. I'm going to get some help. Go to talk therapy. Recently, I started going to a psychologist to pursue the medication pharma side of it. But in the past, it was always talk therapy. So I would, going as far back as like 15 years ago, I guess, I would go to talk therapy for every week for varying amounts of time, 3 months, 6 months. I would kind of, I'm interested in the way the brain works. Like, I find it fascinating how we process things. And so in talk therapy, I learn a ton and I get all of these kind of coping strategies in my back pockets. And then I'm typically able to stop talk therapy for a while and sort of self-help myself. And then eventually it becomes too much and I end up going back and I've been through that cycle 4 times in my life thus far. Right now I am, and every time it gets better. Every time I learn more about myself, I learn more about how our brains work, all that good stuff. And right now, I'm 4 or 5 months into talk therapy with also working with a psychologist, and I'm in a way better place right now, today, here, yesterday, the day before, whatever, than I've ever been. I'm able to see it coming, and it the darkness kind of has a power over me that I can't quite, I can't just turn it off yet, and I might not ever be able to. That's really not how it works. But I'm at least able to kind of see it coming now and just sort of say to myself, like, to get ready for it. This is going to pass. It's going to suck for a while. Just suffer through. And, yeah, this is, so typically what would have happened is that yesterday I would have gotten this news and I would have gone to sleep. Immediately thereafter, I would have slept until it was dark. I would have gotten up in just a complete overwhelmed trance of no conscious Aaron. It would have just been the mental illness, the depression running me, and I would have just been head down on this horrible spiral of autopilot where I'm basically not really, like, conscious. Like, the conscious me, like, the voice in my head is kind of gone, and I'm just on this, like, depression autopilot. And that didn't happen yesterday, and that was really nice. I had a moment yesterday where I was just kind of sitting with Kristen in front of the TV on the floor, in front of the coffee table, actually. And I kind of felt it coming, and I just sort of said, like, fuck it. Like, fuck you. I have a choice. Like, yes, it has this power over me, but I have a choice. And I just, in that moment, kind of said, like, no. I'm not going to be miserable for the rest of the night. There's no reason for that. And, that's big for me. That's really big for me. So, promised myself I wasn't gonna cry. I don't know, man. It's crazy. It's hard, but I feel like I'm in a good place. We're gonna do this together. You guys are coming with me, whether you like it or not, and we're gonna figure this shit out. So, thanks, Pesky. Very cool of you to say that. I recently did a psychological evaluation, and one of the things that came out of it was that like self-esteem stuff. And what Pesky just said, like that really kind of grabbed me because it's a problem I have. I don't have a lot of self-esteem, and you guys help a lot with that. So I appreciate it more than you guys will ever know. And I'm gonna hold it together. God damn it. And it's gonna be cool. Everything's gonna be cool. Let's do this shit. Market Zero, glad you took your sourpuss picture off there. Me too. Admittedly, the thumbnail was a little bit clickbaity, but hey, it's the name of the game on YouTube. Learning how to be a YouTuber. Gotta clickbait that shit. Whew! Okay. Jesse R says, sorry, bud, take advantage of unemployment benefits that you've paid for. I'm sure a talented person like yourself will bounce back, no problem. Thank you for that, Jesse R. For anybody new, do me a favor, tag @CiottiFPV if you want to talk to me. Without a tag, I'm assuming you guys are just kind of talking to each other in chat. If you guys want me to read something, just do the @ symbol, CiottiFPV, and that'll light it up in orange for me. I like to let you guys talk amongst yourselves because you've all seemingly become pretty good friends here as well in the chat, which is great. And yeah, the chat scrolls fast enough where it's hard for me to read everything. So, and yeah, Jesse's right. You know, even this is, as I mentioned, this is like the third time I'm gonna have to be collecting unemployment, but I've been paying into that shit for 23 years. So, sorry, taking some of it. I need it right now. It's all good. That's what we all pay into it for, right? All right. Ask Grace says, remember that one door closes, another one opens. Maybe this is the open door. What do you guys think? Rob Axelson absolutely sucks. Been laid off myself twice. Yeah, Rob. It's not great. Doesn't feel great. Does not feel great. Market Zero, thanks for the $2, man. Very cool of you. Much appreciate it. For the record, this is not like I'm not. This is not a pity party to try to get you guys to give me money at all. I hope that it didn't come off like that. That's definitely not it. You guys are amazing. The fact that you guys just jumped in and started doing super chats is, it's just so cool. It's so hard for me to put into words because it's still like kind of a new thing. But yeah, that's not what it is. I know that a lot of you guys are in the same spot, and like I had somebody message me the other day, like, hey, Ciotti, I'm so sorry, I'm gonna have to drop off as a Patreon. I got let go from my job. I always want you guys to understand that, like, just you hanging out and just looking at me do this is all I need. It's all I ever wanted out of this. And then you guys were cool enough to like push me to do the Patreon. That's been like a fucking blast. So, yeah. There's a crazy storm. There's a huge storm coming through right now. And no, it's not a storm of emotions, you fucks. Yeah, there's a big ass storm coming through right now. But yeah. Tom with $10. Tom, thank you, man. Been laid off before too. Here's some bucks to help with it. It sucks. Thank you, Tom. Very, very cool of you. Much appreciated. Gabriel says that sucks. We're in the same boat. Stay strong, brother. Appreciate it, Gabriel. Market Zero with $2. Where's your sign? We'll work for super chats. Goddamn right. Yeah, I'm gonna. So I've had a bunch of ideas of different things that we can do, like fun video contests and bringing you guys into the mix more and showing some of your videos, and I just haven't had time to do it. I got time to do it. So again, fuck it. Let's do this. Let's see what happens. Off Axis FPV, feel free to join in the other live streams. What do you mean off Axis? Feel free to join in the other live streams. Explain off Axis. What else do we have? What else do we have? Big Willie FPV is gonna watch as often as he can. Keep it up, man. Appreciate it, Big Willie. Oh man. All right. So I don't usually come back and I don't usually go back and watch the streams because I just try to focus on the next one coming up. But I am going to go back and watch this one because there's like a million really, 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 really cool comments from you guys that I don't want to make you guys watch me read all of them. Not to mention that I'll probably become a blubbering mess. But I will be reading all your guys' comments. Yeah, I kind of have to scroll past them right now because I'm going to just lose it. So let me scroll past them. Kind FPV. Your YouTube name says it all. Very, very kind, man. $50. Hashtag FPV love, my brother. I'm feeling the love, man. I appreciate it. Pile of Carbon with 100 SEKs. Is that Swedish educational kroners? I don't think it is. Thank you for the fun content and for what you do for the community. Keep up the good work. You'll sort this out. No sweat. Thank you, Pyle. Very, very cool of you. Really, really appreciate it, man. Big Willie FPV, you're a kick-ass guy, and I'm sure you'll get it handled. Appreciate it, Big Willie. Appreciate the confidence in me, man. Steve-O, last I knew, RDQ was looking to hire some people. Well, that's interesting. I'll be shooting my boys over there an email. Very cool. Ask Race, 100 NOKs. There's the Norwegian Kroners. Thank you for being you. Thank you for being you, Ask. And all you guys. Thank all you guys for being you. Always feel like you can be yourselves here. I desperately try to to do that. And to just always be real and yeah. Mondo FPV, keeping yourself. You're a top dude. Appreciate it, Mondo. Pesky FPV, your career skills will be needed after the lockdown, bro. School is bad for me. And also with the prison. Ooh, Jesus, Pesky. Sometimes you get lost in the system, but you keep shit moving. Yeah, that's true, man. And sounds like you're a success story. You're here. You're kicking ass, man. Keep it going. Hell yeah, Pesky. Love it. Sucks that it sounds like it was shit for a little while, but hey, man, you made it work. All right, let's see if I can get caught up here. Oh, man, I told you guys to tag me, and look, it's all orange. Good on you guys. Kind FPV says, happy 420. Did I miss? No. Oh, where you are. Okay. What are you, West Coast? I'm East Coast. It's 7:30 here already. License to Drive says, oh, shit, just saw the notification. Hope you can survive this. License, hope you can survive this. I'm not going to die, I hope. Jeez. That's a funny choice of words, License. I'm sure you didn't do it on purpose. I will survive. If nothing else, I'll fucking live through this. Worst case scenario, both my parents are still with us. They've got a gigantic RV up in New Jersey, as well as the house that I grew up in. So if all goes to hell, you guys will see a different background, which will be my childhood room growing up, or maybe the inside of an RV. Who knows? But yeah, I'm very, very fortunate to have two wonderful parents that would allow me to come back home with open arms tomorrow. And yeah, not something to take for granted either. I'm very, very lucky to have that. So I will survive. Don't you guys worry. I'll definitely survive. Yeah, don't you worry about that. Rob Axelson, dude, this is your talk therapy. Yeah, it really is, man. It really, you guys really are. Captain Beaurut says, sad to hear it, but that means something better is coming your way. I appreciate it, Captain. And, I agree. This'll get sorted. That's for sure. John Dyson, put your funky glasses on to help us too. I'll put the glasses on. I'm not going to put the lenses down because I did watch a little bit of Monday's stream back, and poof, not a good look, man. Not a good look with these like 20x lenses down with me looking at the camera. But just for you, I'll put these on my head with the lenses folded up until my nose starts hurting, which will take about 2 to 3 minutes. John Dyson, put your funky glasses on. Awesome. June Loco, keep your head up. Like that? Thanks, June. Appreciate it, man. I will. I'm better equipped to do that right now than I've ever been in my life. So, God damn it. I'm just going to stubbornly bash through. Private Island, you got this. Thanks, brother. EBR FPV, everything's going to be cool. You're the best. Yada FPV, thanks, EBR. Much appreciated. It's already hurting. It's already hurting, guys. The I put the batteries back into the damn thing. It's already hurting my nose. Jasper Singer, sometimes... where did it go? Sometimes you just got to put your back up against the wall and muddle through. Goddamn right, Jasper. So fucking true. Spoken like somebody who's had to do it before. So, yeah. Keep being strong, brother. I will follow suit. Tiago says, see the positive side. You have time to do reviews. When life gives you lemonade. When life gives you lemons, do lemonade. I will do lemonade, goddammit. Chan Wang says, don't cry, honest bro. You got this. Hell, I sub and I got no job. My girl thinks it's really awesome that you talk about mental health, as do I. Thanks for that, Chan. And Chan's lovely girlfriend, wife, domestic partner, whatever you guys got going on. Love it all. I appreciate you mentioning that about mental health. It's really difficult for me to talk about. It's a pretty emotional thing, but it's also a really important thing. So I will continue to talk about it. If you don't like that, sucks for you, but there are people in your life with it. And I'm going to keep talking about it to force you to be a better person and to understand it more so that the day that one of those people comes to you or they ditch out on a plan for like the fourth time in a row, instead of saying, well, fuck you, I'm just not going to be your friend anymore, you can say to them, like, you all right? What's going on? I've noticed you've been a little distant, seeing what's going on. How can I help? A buddy of mine, Ciotti, on the internet, he's got mental health issues. He mentioned something like this. You ever been checked out? Stuff like that. So I'll keep doing it, goddammit. And you guys are going to have to keep hearing about it. But it's something that affects all of us. And it's getting worse and worse with us trying to cram more and more into our brains with social media, news, everything, just 24/7 marketing, all this stuff. It's going to get worse before it gets better. So, yeah, the only way to beat it is to talk about it, and I'm not going to let it win. So, here we go. IMAX says, sorry about your job. We'll lead to something better. I agree, man. Thank you. Pile of Carbon, being the Micro King, maybe build, tune, and sell custom whoops, toothpicks, and 3-inch Pile of Carbon. I love that idea. Here's the problem. The way that I build and tune and everything, I would have to sell them for, like, to make... So photography became a thing, and I started making money from it and learned about the business side of it. And in doing so, just kind of learned about running your own business in general. And essentially what you figure out is you got to really be careful with what your time is. You got to make sure that your time is worth it, right? So like my career, I'm able to make 40 to 60, no, probably less than that. Maybe like $30 to $50 an hour. And then I get a huge discount on health insurance, right? So that bumps that up even more. So, and the life that I have, right? The rent that we pay here, the cars that are, well, I mean, my car is paid off, but Kristen's car has small monthly payments, because it's only a $12,000 car anyway. But yeah, like the life that I'm in, right? Requires some version of that hourly wage for me to work roughly 8 hours a day. And so if I want to work for myself, I got to do the same thing, right? I can't just charge $20 an hour. Like, I'll starve. And at $40 to $60 an hour, my builds take a long time. They fly the way that they do because I put a bunch of time and love into them, right? Yeah, sure, I would speed up, but realist, and I've kind of sort of done the math because I've had that same thought a bunch of times, and I would just get crushed by all the stuff coming out of China, which is almost as good. Hell, some of the stuff now is just as good. Like, I look at some of these bind and flies now, and I'm like, that's how I would have built it. That's the size motor I would have put on it. That's the flakes drool I would have put in it. So yeah, it would be, I would have to sell them at like triple, and sure, some people would pay for them, in theory, but I would actually rather teach you guys how to do it. Like, I would rather, yeah, I would rather spend my time educating everybody so that we can continue to kind of hive mind this shit and groupthink this shit and get micros flying better. But if any of you guys are interested, like if you guys are willing, and I'll tell you super up, like I just did, it's they'll be expensive, but if any of you guys ever do want like a Ciati FPV build, for sure reach out to me. We'll spec it out. And I'll tell you what it's gonna cost. It's gonna be expensive, but I'll tell you what it's gonna cost, and it's gonna be gnarly, and it's gonna fly great, and it's gonna be built in a way that you can service it easily. So you'll be getting something for the money for sure. But doing that as a like a here's the other thing. I don't love building. As you guys probably already know, building is like towards the bottom of the list of things that we do in FPV that I enjoy. So I wouldn't necessarily want to sign myself up for that, right? And do this thing that has the potential of kind of ruining the hobby for me. But yeah, it's if you guys want it, it's on you to let me know. Otherwise, I'm gonna keep doing what I'm doing, and I'm just gonna blow it up a little bit bigger. But I love that you mentioned that pile. It's cool that you guys would. It's cool that anybody would even think of that to be willing to do that. To be willing to buy something that I built. That's pretty cool, and I do appreciate that. Mondo FPV with five squigglies. Ciati, I would be so lost if the FPV community wasn't here. I'm feeling that for sure now, Mondo. I really am. Yesterday and today have been very weird. And it's funny because one of the first things that I thought yesterday was, I gotta go stream. And then it was very quickly followed up by, let me just hold on. I'll stream tomorrow. But you guys were kind of one of the first things that came to mind. And I pretty quickly thought, well, like, well, shit, now I can stream every day and hang out with the guys every day. And that's pretty cool. I really dig that. June Loco with $3, no comment, just a funny little guy saying fist bump. Thank you, June Loco, much appreciated. Scarecrow FPV with $10. Scarecrow, thank you, man. How you been holding up? So Kristen does freelance graphic design, and initially a lot of her clients canceled, but she's been getting some work. I'm curious as to how you're doing on the photography side of things. I know you're working with well, I won't say. I don't know if I should. But I know who you're working with, and I think they're still doing fine. But yeah, man, let me know. Let me know. I'm interested. I'm always interested in what you're up to. You're the man when it comes to photography in this hobby. I'm always stalking you from the shadows, trying to learn a thing or two. Mech. Woo! I'm gonna have to try with this one. Mechanicurn. Got it. Sorry, man. Shit, hope you're prepared and have a plan. Eh, not really, but I'll come up with one. I lost one of my jobs too. It's gonna be okay. Hope you'll pull through. Appreciate it, man. I definitely will. Whoa! Chat blew up again. Wow, I'm so far behind. Okay, I guess I need to go faster because you guys are awesome and you're just hurling support at me, and I'm being too slow getting through it. So let's do it. John Dyson. Hey Kidda, it's a real man. Wait, what? Oh. It's a real man who can show his emotions. Thank you, John. I don't have much of a choice. They're kind of here and they come out when they want to, but yeah, it is what it is. Marley Leppo with 50 Norwegian kroners. He says, I am not playing. Marley was not playing on Monday with those with that giveaway, and he's not playing today either. I appreciate it, Marley. Very cool of you. Fumanciano with $10. Much love, man. Keep your head up. Fuman, I most certainly will. Is it Fuman or Fuman? Gotta get it right. Gotta respect your guys' names, and get them right to the best of my ability. Shine Kopf, head up, especially when you're up to your neck in shit greetings from Germany. They're not shit greetings. They're great greetings. I love your guys' greetings. Sean Wang. Hey, here we go. Here's an FPV question. Thank you, Sean. Recommended max weight for 1103 3S 40mm gem fans. 40mm. What's 40mm? 40mm in inches. 1.5 inches. Whew! That's a tiny little prop, brother. You're going to need all the KV in the world. But that's not what you're asking. You're asking recommended max weight. Very interesting question. So, it's actually a really good way. Sean has asked this question kind of perfectly. Because max weight and the size of the prop, like, that's really it. Like, you're all up weight and the size of your prop. If I only had two specs to pick to try to make a rig fly well, that's kind of it, right? So here's the deal. The size of the propellers, oh, that made a mess. Oh God, there's things falling. The size of the propellers act as a parachute, right? So we've got 3-inch propellers on this guy. So at idle, inverted, right side up, you know, knife edge, doesn't matter. The propellers are going to act as some sort of an umbrella to kind of come down on. So if your propellers are too small for the weight, it just, the rig just sort of tumbles out of the sky like a sack of hammers. And what'll happen is, like, for me at least, I'll go to do something where I'm off the throttle and I'm falling down, but I'm not looking at the ground, and there's like an amount of hang time that I expect, that I'm used to from all the other rigs I've ever flown and built. And when the prop size is too small for the all-up weight, it catches you out because all of a sudden you hit the ground. And that's one of the hardest things for me to adjust to. And it's also why I tend to gravitate towards these 200-ish rig all-up weight 3-inch quads, because that all-up weight to prop, discloading is one of the words for it, but let's not get into that. Yeah, that weight to prop size gives me roughly the same amount of hang time that I'm used to. One of the reasons I stayed away from toothpicks is because I knew, from my experience with really lightweight 3-inch rigs from back in 2017, that it's the opposite of that, where you get more hang time. And that then makes my job harder when I fly 5-inch, because all of a sudden on 5-inch rigs, I'm bashing a GoPro into the ground when it doesn't make any sense to me, right? I thought that I would have more hang time because I'd been flying XYZ super lightweight, big-ass props rig. So kind of cool that Chan asked the question in that way. I swear to God, I'm not stalling for the answer because I actually don't know the answer. I've never had a rig with 1.5mm props or 1.5-inch props. So what I'll do is I'll give you a best guess that is basically coming from the experience that I have with 1.2-inch props and 2-inch props. So for a 2-inch prop, all up weight, I would want to stay below like 120 or so grams. And then on the complete ass opposite side, which is 1.2-inch, which is the smallest of the tiny whoops, you know, like the classic 65mm tiny whoop. Those rigs, I try to keep those below like 40 or so all up grams. So that would put a 1.5-inch prop like kind of right in between there. So I would have to say like maybe 60 or 70 is probably going to be the upper end of the weight to size of umbrella or parachute, whatever you want, however you want to think about it, ratio, that's going to give you something that somewhat resembles the bigger rigs. And not just that, but like that's the style of flying that I think looks best, right? Like you don't want to take too long to kind of come down, because then you're just sort of waiting, because you can't really power yourself down. You can, but it's super creepy, and it's hard to do inverted thrust in a way that's like not reliably, but controllably, and it's hard to do it every time and get it right. So yeah, I'm thinking like 60 to 70 grams all up, maybe 80 if you really push it. I think that's where you're gonna want to be. And 1103s are a really good choice, as is 3S. You can probably drop down to 2S as long as you get motors that have enough kV. You're gonna want to spin the shit out of those props. You're gonna be looking for like, so if you're on 3S, least kV I would say would be like 7500. And then if you drop down to 2S, you're gonna need 10,000 kV and up, to turn those little 1.5 inch props fast enough to get us to get a good amount of thrust for that setup. So there's a long answer to a short question, but a really good question, and I love how you worded it. That's a very wise kind of way to think through that build. So take notes, folks. Chan knows what's up. Brandon Bentley got laid off right away at the beginning of April. Been flying more now than ever before as a result. Go take advantage and file for unemployment for employment all while flying your most. Deal, Brandon. I will definitely stream more than ever. And if the rain goes away, I'll start flying a bunch too. And I'll bring you guys along for the ride. License to drive. Sorry, didn't mean to be so dramatic, but hell, losing your driving this time isn't a walk in the park. Yeah, it's true. Just messing with the license. I'm sure you know that. I was just fucking with you. Fu Man Shano, much love. Keep your head up. I think I already said that, but you get two shout outs because 10 bucks is the real deal. Much appreciated, man. Captain Bo Root with 10 different squigglies that looks like a letter E. Not much, but I'm also unemployed. Sorry, man. We'll get through it. We can do this. Panic FPV. I've had down times. I had to lean on my dad a couple of times. Sure, love it. Content or content. Sure, love your content. I see you corrected it. Appreciate it, man. Really do appreciate it. And yeah, man, you know what I mean about having good parents. It's very humbling, actually. It's yeah, very, very humbling to have such hardworking, loving, caring, amazing parents. And it's not something that it's something that I really try hard not to take for granted. I know that I do take it for granted, but I try every day to not take it for granted as much as I did the day before. Monkey Shine FPV with 20 bucks. Dude, thank you so much. Super cool. Keep up the killer content, brother. You'll see a bright future coming your way. Just have faith. Appreciate it, man. I don't have religious faith, but I do have faith in myself. So thank you, brother. I appreciate that. Nathaniel LeVoo, the Boof. Get them new review vids done. Micro King. Thanks, Nathaniel. Keep pushing me. All you guys keep pushing me to do the review vids. The reviews are going to be here on the live stream. So that's going to be one of the reasons why I'm forcing myself to do streams every single day. Because eventually here, I'll run out of things to talk about and I'll have to do the reviews. So keep pushing me for the reviews because I owe Emacs, I owe Banggood, and I owe. Kind of, sort of owe Beta FPV, but I'm still waiting for a camera to get the one build done. My review for them is going to be like a full scratch build, which will be pretty cool. With their, they sent me a Toothpick AIO, and they sent me a Tiny Whoop AIO, and a set of their 0802 22,000s for the Tiny Whoop. For the Tiny Whoop, I'm just waiting on a camera. I can't figure out a good camera solution. I really want to do the tinywhoop.com new what's it called? Split? It's not called Split. It's called, I forget what their new camera is called, but the Tiny Whoop camera is made by FXT and they make amazing cameras and I've been so happy with their old school one that I really want to try their new one. But there's no canopy for it yet. I'm waiting on a canopy. So I got to get that figured out. I might just I hate to do it. It's a secret, but you guys hear me? You guys can hear me. Kristen's Tiny Whoop has their old camera. I might just steal that shit. We'll see. We'll see. I really want to get that built though. Yeah, I really do. Freelojo says it'll be all good. Thanks, Freelojo. Appreciate it. Oh my god, what happened to the chat again? There it goes. Killer B. Easy to service as long as you don't pick up an Acrobrat or Remix Frame. Can't speak to the Remix Frame. Acrobrat Frame's not actually that bad. It's not, I mean, it's a little different, but not that bad once you've taken it apart a bunch of times. Not the easiest, not the hardest, though. Alex Navarrete, what about signed microframes? That'd be cool. I one of the things I am going to now have time for is working with McStarcoin on frame design. So if I can get my frame designed and done, hell yeah, I'll sign the shit out of them. I got to make a signature for myself. I don't like at the bank or whatever, I just sign in cursive, but that's no fun. Leviathan, so sorry, wish you the best of luck. Thanks, Leviathan, appreciate it. Chan Wang has been building himself for years. I can help build for you or others. I love building. There you guys go. If you're totally fed up with building, message Sean Wang. He will hook you up. Very cool of you, brother. Free Lojo to the Ciati Collective. Building in my favorite part. Programming is a headache. That's funny. I would actually rather program than build. Free Lojo, move to Atlanta. Let's work together, man. Ben Holmquist. What's up, Ben from Charleston? You'll sort this out, my man. What about covering events with drone videos? Would be some nice money. I would love to do that, man. I keep meaning to hit you up, Ben, to get linked up with you because you're doing all the Red Bull stuff. Ben, for anybody that doesn't know, why would you know? Ben has one of the coolest jobs ever. He works for Red Bull and drives this ridiculous truck of theirs around to events and then sets it up, and there's screens and swag and all kinds of good stuff. And yeah, I need to get my part 107 and get my ass linked up with Ben when he comes up towards here and does events and hopefully fly them. So yeah, that's in the works. That's going to be a little bit of a longer road, but, I got to get on that. I got to get a goddamn car too, so that I can get myself to the events, but we'll figure it out. Thanks Ben. Thanks for the kind words, man. Look forward to the next time you're up. Next time you're up here, hit me up, dude. Crash here. This is where the world's most comfortable air mattress goes. Come on up, hang out. Chris and I would love to hang out with you and Molly. So, yeah, let me know next time you're up this way. License to drive. I was asked at 16, what do I see in my future? I replied blackness, which worried my teachers. But it's true. Has been that way for 30 years. Has Asperger's and have never had an official job. That's rough, license. I wish I didn't know what you meant about the word blackness, but unfortunately I do. Probably almost guaranteed not to the level that you do. But keep going, brother. You've made it 30 years. Fuck it. Make it another 30. May as well. That's what I keep telling myself. It's like, I've made it this far. Screw it. I'll just keep going and see what happens. Roscoe6, hey, sorry to hear about your job. Keep the chin up. I will, brother. Chan Wang, thanks in here. 1103 going 8,000 kV. Nice. That'll be perfect on 3S, brother. Goodwin with $4.99. No comment. Thank you, Goodwin. Much, 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 much appreciated, my man. Four Eyes FPV says, hello. What's up, Four Eyes? All right. Keep on scrolling. Keep on scrolling. And Athix, will you do any flight edits? Goddamn right I will. I love the crane video. Ooh, that one's not done yet, so I'll finish that one. I was actually editing last night. I have an alarm on my phone. I put an alarm on my phone about 2 weeks ago, for 8 o'clock every night that says edit, no excuses, edit in all capitals and then no excuses. And every night the alarm comes on and I'm busy with something else and I turn it off. But last night the alarm went off. And I was already in this headspace of, I'm going to stream every day. I'm going to do more. I'm going to not just curl up into a hole of depression. And speak of the devil. That's weird. That's very weird. It's a little weird that we got on this topic at 7:59. But I did some editing last night. It wasn't on the crane. It was on the Charlotte edit between those two buildings in that little flow cube, and it's coming out pretty good. I'm pretty happy with it, and it's also pretty close to being done. There was a I did something different on this edit. I edited it from back to front. There was an ending that I really wanted, and so I tried to go backwards with the edit, which was really interesting. Yeah, guys, put your age in the everybody type your age in the chat. I'm curious. Yeah, so and I didn't like doing it that way. It took a long time to do it that way, but it was very interesting and it taught me a lot, weirdly. What's interesting is I used to teach that with at autocross. So one of the things about autocross is that it's a different racetrack every time. So basically the event organizers show up at like 5:30, 6 a.m. and they've got a trailer full of cones and they build a racetrack with those cones. It just occurred to me that most of you guys probably don't know what autocross looks like or have ever heard of it, so I'm gonna pull up a video on my channel and I'll of it to give you guys some idea, and I'll just let that play while I talk here, just to kind of help you folks that aren't super into motorsports. All right, yeah, so here's what autocross looks like. Racetrack changes every single event. And I'll turn this down a little bit. Well, I kind of can't turn it down, but I'll just talk over it. So the first thing that you do as a driver, as a competitor, is you walk the racetrack. And one of the things that I learned from the guys that run the national circuit, like essentially the best autocross drivers in the country, pretty much in the world too, come to think of it, they would look backwards from time to time at the layout, because when you look backwards, you see things that you don't when you're walking it forward. You can kind of see the exits to the corners a little bit different. Sometimes you can see spots where you can really run like a straight line in between two gates. So it's kind of that's something that I started teaching as an instructor for however the hell many years that was, 7 or 8 years, I guess. And it's funny because it was something that people would actually come back to me and be like, dude, that's such a great tip. Like, thank you for telling me that. Because I would instruct for people who'd been driving for like many, many years, and they would be like, yeah, I never thought to do that. And like all of a sudden now I've dropped a quarter of a second or a couple tenths or whatever. So yeah, I don't know. In life, maybe you just gotta look backwards sometimes. Because it's happened to me in two hobbies in a row now. So maybe I should just do it all the time. But yeah, that's what autocross is. Lay the cones out, build a racetrack. One of the first things you learn as a driver in autocross is how to read the cones. So like I know like the first thing that everybody says is, oh, I just get lost. You do. You get lost at your first event, you use the instructors a bunch, and then they all of a sudden you're like, oh right, that basically what we do is there's a vertical cone, you don't want to hit that one, and then there's a pointer cone. It's a cone that's on its side. And the pointer cone is telling you basically which direction to go. So your first like event or two, you just learn to look farther ahead for a pointer cone that says go this way, dummy, and then you go that way, and all is well. And then it becomes an actual racetrack, which an autocross is going to cost you about $40 to go do, versus a track day with like a real racetrack with you know the red and white apex markers and all that good stuff, curbing and whatnot. That's gonna cost you $400 to $500. Well, $300 to $500 per day. So yeah, that's why I was into autocross mainly. And then as an instructor, I got pulled in and was able to do some track day work for free. But yeah, look backwards sometimes. Maybe it'll help. So that's autocross. Let's get that out of there. Nobody wants to see my nonsense car shit, I'm sure. Or maybe you guys do. If you do, you can find it all on my YouTube channel. Click my name, do whatever you want. All the fun things. I think we're almost there in the chat. What else do we have? Free Lojo is 37. Noah Reinhardt is 200. Noah, how the hell are you, man?
Haven't seen a hot minute. Free Lojo with $12. Thank you, man. I don't know if I told you guys to leave your ages, and the chat went ballistic. So if I didn't get you, thanks, Free Lojo. Much, much, much appreciated. Really does mean a lot. Blizzard FPV, appreciate the hearts. Mandalorian, nothing much to just peer pressuring Ciotti into working on his frame and his downtime. Mandalorian, what did I miss, bros? I think you're probably caught up by now, Mandalorian. Alex Navarrete tagging me. What's up, Alex? How are you? And Athix with some love on the flight edits. And I'm also going to do some streams while I'm editing. I know you guys have, a couple of you guys have expressed interest in that, so I'm definitely going to do that. I'll try to have like a theme, like I typically do. I'll try to schedule the stream and then have a topic, and so there'll be, you know, an editing stream. Maybe, you know what? Maybe I'll schedule it out. Maybe it'll be like, I would have to do it with puns because that's just sort of what I do. But like Thursday, like, I don't know, Thursday, the edit. I'll figure out. That would probably help me too. It'd probably help me to schedule that out and have like, okay, Thursday is my editing day. Friday is fuck around day. Wednesday is repair shop day or something like that. So yeah, we'll, I'll figure something cool out to do with that. Look at these ages, 37, 50, 20, 30, 200, 25, 44, 50. Jesus Christ, we have a hell of a range of ages. 38, 45, 43, 27, 29, 37, 43, 26, 56, 44, 38, 36, 45, 50. You motherfuckers are old. We got some old bastards in here. And now that's why this crowd is so cool, because it's all these 30 and 40 and 50-year-olds. Shit, I didn't realize. I thought it was a little younger of a crowd. Okay. So I'm not, I guess I'm not that old compared to you guys. Whew. I feel young at heart now. Shit. 40, 46, 29, 53, 37, 35, 39, and 40 next week. Happy soon-to-be birthday, Chan. Oh, Chan. I turned 39 a couple weeks ago. You're turning 40, bro. Ooh. Sorry, man. I'm going to lose my mind when I turn 40, for the record. Fair warning. When I turned 29, I had like a midlife meltdown, because I was only 1 year away from 30. Didn't happen a couple weeks ago when I turned 39, but ooh, 40 gonna be rough. Dr. Colin with $10. Thank you, doctor. Are you a real doctor? I like that spelling. Doc. Are you a boat guy? Is that what the D-O-C-K refers to? Much appreciated, man. Really, really do. It does mean a lot. Whoa, come on, chat. Don't do that. Back up in the chat. Back up in the chat. Here we go. Okay. Alex Navarrete, I said in my previous comment that I forgot to tag you in. I would 100% buy your signature frame. Very cool, Alex. If I can get this frame done, it'll be fairly inexpensive. It'll be like a $25 frame. So, and it'll be the best 3-inch frame that's ever been produced. I kind of sort of say that tongue in cheek, but it actually is. I feel like I might have more invested in micros than maybe anybody else at this point, maybe. And I've certainly crashed them a lot more than anybody else, and I've kind of been taking notes for a long time. So, yeah, I mean, if you fly freestyle and you want something durable, this is going to be the one. So, we'll see. We'll see how it goes. It's going to be dope. Hope you guys are going to be ready for it. First run, I'm going to make a shitload after the prototype phasing is done. So we going to get it. Tiago says, you're a effing project manager. Come on, you're certified to do a schedule. Yeah, I know. I try not to schedule my own life because I deal with that shit all day long. So I try to live my life as loose as I possibly can. But sometimes you got to practice what you preach. Some more ages, 48, 46, 44, 31, 43, 37. Damn. Off axis, you're 65? I didn't realize. Ooh, off axis has got that experience. Oh, now he's 91. Damn, he aged quick. Woo-hoo-hoo-hoo. Everybody, show your love to off axis because he's about to die. He went from 65 to 91 in, looks like 4 to 5 seconds. So, it's been great knowing you, brother. I won't be at your funeral. I'm sorry. 36, 61, 14, 33, 49, 44, 39. Jakina Backpacks, yada FPV. I guess you can get to that 5,000 sub count now. That'd be pretty cool. I hit 3,000 a while ago. I've been kind of stuck in the 3,000s, mainly because I just haven't, I haven't been a good SEO person, and I just haven't been getting it out there enough. But now I've got time, so we'll see. We'll make it work. Parts for Bent Toys, experience equals chill. Agreed. And Free Lojo says, age is a state of mind, not a constraint. Agreed, my man. Agreed. Mondo says, 40 is the new 20. Hope so. Alex Navarrete, $20 to $30 3-inch frames would be bomb as F. Would love a race edition, too. What do you want from the race edition? More up tilt? Because I'm not going to do a specific race frame, but are there top mount race frames? I know a lot of the race guys go for bottom mount because the theory behind it is the weight on the bottom makes it land battery down more often than not. So I doubt that I'll do a bottom mount battery frame, but we could certainly do a top plate with a more... with a more aggressive camera cutout so that you can run more up tilt. That is for sure something that we'd be willing to do. I just don't necessarily know if I want to sign up to design a race frame that I'm not, like, that I'm going to have other people test in that environment, right? Grass crashes, hitting PVC, hitting foam noodles, stuff like that. I wouldn't want to just... Okay, more uphill will be perfect. Okay, good. Yeah, so that's what it'll be. That's what the version of my... I'm not just going to reinvent the wheel and try to make a race frame just for the sake of doing it, right? I'm going to just throw everything I have into this one frame and try to make it kind of cover as many bases as possible. So that's cool. That sounds good to you. Pappy Rocks says, do a GoFundMe for your frame. I'll buy at least two. Pappy Rocks, I don't know what I'm going to do to sell the frames. It's far away. It's months and months away. But yeah, maybe I'll do something like that. I'll have to figure out some retail-ish way of capturing addresses and payments and whatnot. So we'll figure that out. Probably together, as I typically do on this channel. I just hive mind it all. Ciati Collective, the Borg. Bring that shit on, yo. More up to it will be perfect. Would also test it for free. Yeah, when time comes, I'll be reaching out to some folks for some crash testing. If you're willing to, I mean, basically with prototype testing, I send you guys the frames for free, and you're kind of on the hook for whatever you break. The understanding of the frame being sent to you for free is that you're gonna at least break something or other, because that's the feedback that we need for that prototyping phase. So yeah, I'll offer that to whoever's interested when the time comes, and if you guys are willing to bang up a couple motors for the good of the community, that's pretty awesome, because that's what you'll break a lot of when testing a prototype frame. It's one of the reasons why I have such a stack of destroyed motors, is that Kebab has sent me a bunch of prototypes, and Rotorius has as well, and I take the prototype testing really serious and really just go full send, as the kids say, and yeah, it tears stuff up, but I don't care. That frame is going to be better whether it likes it or not. June Loco, what's the best freestyle frame and race frame you recommend? I'm not going to touch the race frames with a 10-foot pole. Yes, I am. Because everybody seems to be going over to it. Evan's frame, what is it, 533? Somebody will comment in the chat. I think it's 533, F-I-V-E-3-3. It's Evan Turner's frame, and that's the one that, like, a lot of racers are going over to. Like Alex Vanover, for example, he has his own frame from X-Hover that he's not even flying anymore. He's gone over to Evan Turner's frame. So, yeah, that's probably the best racing frame. best freestyle frame really depends on what all up weight you want to be at. For me, I want to be as close, or I want to be as light as possible, within reason. And that has been the FPV cycle glide frame. With this frame and the way that I do my builds, I can get this to 600 to 610 grams all up with a session, 6S 1050, 4 to 5 minutes runtime, fully protected TPU covered GoPro session, and with room for ND filters. So yeah, it's not the strongest frame in the world, but what I, one of the things I really like about it is when the arms break, they break at a level of impact where it would have broken something else, something electronic, a motor, something more expensive, essentially. So yeah, Bob has found this, and he's found this through a lot of prototype testing, right? Like I've helped him on the version one of his frame, and now with this one, he sent me prototypes early on, and he does that. He sends a lot of frames out for prototype testing, and he takes the feedback very seriously. He doesn't, like, one of my favorite things about Bob is that when I come to him and say, like, hey man, here's where it broke, or here's what happened, the response isn't, he doesn't try to stand up for the frame and make excuses. And that's something that means, like, as a project manager, that's something that I deal with a lot. Like, I don't care what the reasoning was behind doing something a certain way. It failed, it broke, it can possibly be improved. Let's talk about the improvements and the end, right? Like, I don't care why you did it that way. It does no good for you to make excuses, right? Let's just deal with the situation and fix it to the best of our ability. And Bob has always been that way, and it's always been so great to work with him and to talk to him, and yeah, just such a good approach towards improving. And like he made an improvement to the glide frame like 2 months ago, because I broke like three of them in the same spot. He's like, you know, it's like a production product. It's the frame is done, but he beefed up the front of it because it wouldn't impact anybody who already has it. And it's a better design now. And for like maybe an extra gram, if that, it's way stronger in this one spot where I kept breaking it. So yeah, man, just really, really good frame designed by somebody who cares about making it better, not making money. Making it better, not making it cheaper. Love it. Chan Wang is in to test anything. Awesome. Chad FPV will buy one of the frames for his XJB. Awesome. Leviathan, if you want something to test, frame for racing test. Awesome. So it looks like you guys are pretty down to test, and that's super cool. I assume that you guys would be, but it's good to know that. KD2RDH Harry. Your hair looks pretty suave. You'll find success soon. Follow whatever the good hair takes you. Thank you, KD. Much appreciated. I'll be a hair model. Oh my god! Alright, almost caught up on chat. That's like my broken record thing. I should just record. Oh, almost caught up on chat and put on a little soundboard here. I can just push a button instead of wasting my breath. 533 switchback. That's what it's called, the switchback. Larry asks, is that a bicopter on your wall? If so, how do you like it compared to your quad and tri? I've never flown anything but a quad. I've never flown a fixed wing. I've never flown tri, like any of the fun stuff. Everything on the wall is broken prototype frames, basically. I think you might be talking about this one. This is just that's, what is that? Oh, that's Ryan Harrell's frame. That's Ryan Harrell's, mini quad test bench crush frame, which is a normal frame, but, those are, so the wall is for when stuff breaks. So, that has two broken arms on it, and the other arms I, gave with the giveaway. There was a giveaway for that frame, and I included the two good arms in that giveaway. Oh boy, smack this. And then yeah, this guy up here, it's the same deal. The one, it had one good arm on it, and I robbed that arm for a working rig. And then a couple micros. That's the original CB3. It's actually called the CB122 that I was flying at Quad Camp Atlanta with the Power Loop Matty Flip tables nonsense. And then that eventually had to get retired because it was a solid base plate, and I eventually broke three out of the four arms. And this is the Wemix that got run over by the car on its maiden battery. We won't talk any more about that. And then down here, these are working rigs. Just the bottom row is working rigs, and then everything up here is blown up prototypes that I feel bad throwing away. Plus, I like to hang on to broken carbon to see where it breaks, to see it's I don't know. Carbon is a funny thing, and it's yeah, it's there's been a couple times where, in thinking about my own frame design, I've had like a certain little area that I'm like, what would be the strongest and the lightest? And I can grab a bunch of these broken prototype frames and see where they broke and be like, okay, and get some idea of like, okay, I don't want to slim it down there. It needs to be beefier here. And like, I'm not doing the CAD for this stuff, but I just have this like ongoing Google Doc that I just kind of put ideas for, and I'll like take a picture of like, where the two arms meet and be like, this held up really well. Take another picture of one that didn't hold up well and be like, this held up like shit. So I got this Google Doc with all this good info on it. So yeah. The life of a crazy person. June, I promised Jamie Ann that I would mention this. Jamie Ann is selling a bunch of DJI stuff. If you're looking to get started on the DJI ecosystem, hit up Little Stellar Fox. She's getting rid of a set of goggles, a bunch of air modules, maybe three, I think she said. Wait, no, she texted it to me. Here, I'll tell you exactly what she's selling. She is selling goggles, radio, three full air units for $1,100. I don't know if that's a good deal. I've not paid any attention to what the DJI stuff costs because I'm just not in a place to make the switch financially. But there you go. Goggles, radio, three full air units, $1,100. Little Stellar Fox on Instagram, Patreon, Facebook. Hit her up. First come, first serve. Oh, June Loco got timed out. What did you do, is June Loco? Oh, selling stuff. Yeah, I guess we shouldn't do for sale stuff in the chat. Yeah, that could turn into a hot mess. Yeah, I don't know. Yeah, so message her, first come, first serve. Is that all I was looking up on my phone? Yeah, I think it was. And Stuck in Trees says hello. What's up, Stuck in Trees? Aethix says kebabs motors are quality motors for the price that they are. What else do we have here? Ever see the show IT Crowd? I did. I loved IT Crowd when I was in my 20s. I watched the whole series, and then for whatever reason, I've tried to revisit it a couple times, and it's just not funny to me anymore. I want it to be funny because I remember it being funny. But I don't know. I guess my taste in humor has changed a little bit, and it's just not my favorite anymore. I am. So, my typical rotation with comedies is, off the top of my head, Frasier, Community, Rick and Morty. I'm a bit. Kristen, my wife, and I are huge Dan Harmon fans. Dan Harmon is the creator of Community and Rick and Morty and Monster House. And he's got an amazing podcast called Harmontown, and there's an amazing documentary on Netflix about him called Harmontown. What else? Parks and Rec, of course. Oh man, I'm missing a lot. I'm missing a lot of them. But yeah, I don't know. That to give you guys some idea of what I'm at. It was just an itch. I don't know why I attacked it like that. Why is she selling? Because I believe it's because she's fallen in love with micros. all she's been flying are like toothpicks and whoops. And it's hard to put DJI on those because that shit's still heavy. S. Grace says, what do you think about the new TBS Source 5? Looks promising to me and I really like the price tag. I am not familiar. Source 5 frame. Look at that. That's not it. That's the V3. Source, let's put a V in front of the 5. See what that does. Nope. Tell me what to search for on Google, if you don't mind. I want to look at it. I'm interested. All right. Nabi, what is up? Tried doing color correction with my flat GoPro footage. Tell me what you think. I'm assuming that there is an edit on your website. I will take a look tonight. Steven Rossi has designed a few frames. One idea I shamelessly stole from Halo RC's Osiris frame that I put into a 3-inch frame was to make the arm shorter, like an H frame, and use a carbon spine in between. Yeah, I've been looking at that. I also like, I love what Impulse did with the Apex in putting that like keystone in the center. Yeah, there are a lot of different ideas. The big challenge, do I have a Zoot frame somewhere? I do. So the big challenge that I'm facing in trying to keep the weight really low, but still have a lot of strength is, so this is what I originally intended to do, which was to separate, just like the kebabs frames, separate the front arms and link the front arms together and link the rear arms together, and then leave the center area where the stack mounts to be isolated from the vibrations coming into those arms. And if you're going to do like a true X with the arms pushed forward a little bit, or if you're going to swing the arms down so it's more of an H frame, you can pull that off. But then durability comes into question. Having a squish X with as much angle, as much forward angle as possible, really, really helps, because most of our crashes are nose in, right? Like most of our crashes are putting a bunch of energy backwards, right? Putting energy in this direction. So the more swept forward your arms are, the better they're going to handle that. They're going to put more energy into the shear direction, which the hardware is very strong in that shear direction. So the it's probably going to be just like this. It's probably going to be meet in the middle type of a design, again, just because we're trying to really keep the weight low and the durability as high as possible, and those two things really fight against one another. But yeah, we'll see. It's not going to be, I hope that I don't just design one. I hope that I can design multiples, and you never know. You never do know. Search TBS Source V. It's on the homepage on pre-order. All right, let's search that. TBS Source V. Let's see what we got. TBS Source V. Let me share my screen. I think that should work. And, oh, I have seen this. The box frame thing is very interesting to me. So for me personally, there's not going to be any way to keep props out of view. So I have no interest in this frame. That is like very high up in my list of requirements for a frame, is that you can keep the props completely out of view all the way down to like 20 degrees up tilt. Lately, all the way down to 0 degrees up tilt. So a frame like this will never do that. And yeah, so that kind of unfortunately disqualifies it for me personally, but these box frames really seem to be taken off. They seem to be really durable, which makes a lot of sense. They're triangulating everything. They're creating triangles in the whole frame, which is, it's going to be way, way, way strong. So yeah, I think the box frame thing is really cool, and I can't wait to see how it continues to evolve. Not for me, unfortunately. But for a race frame, or if you don't care about props in view, or some people like props in view, that could be the one, man. It could be the frame. Todd's got to run. Relax for a few days. You'll figure it out. Appreciate that, Todd. Be good. Right. Source V is dead cat. It does look like it's a little bit dead catted, but I can just tell from where those motors are sitting, and where the nose is sitting, that there's just no way that there aren't going to be props in view. Like for example, right? the front of the Glide, make sure I got it on the right camera. The front of the Glide having the GoPro here, which is almost completely even with the prop nuts, this barely gets the props out of view at 30 degree up tilt. In order to get the props out of view at 0 degree up tilt on this frame, Kebab has a set of dead cat front arms that rotate the motors all the way out here. So, I mean, essentially, here's the easiest way to think about it, right? If you want no props in view at a 30 degree up tilt, the center line of your motors has to be pretty much even with the center line of the bottom of your, the front bottom of your GoPro session. That's an easy way to kind of think about that. And this Source 5 frame, I mean, the center line of the GoPro is going to be like, it looks like a full inch behind the center line of the front motor nuts. So you'd have to run like, my guess would be like 50 degrees of up tilt to get the props out of you on this Source 5. And I'm just never going to do that. I'm never going to build a rig with that much up tilt. It's just not my flight style. So, wow, 63 grams. That's light. S. Gray says it's only 63 grams too. That's pretty good. John Dyson, in frame design, will 3-inch frame upscale to 5-inch, or is there more to it? Yeah, unfortunately, there's more to it. There is a lot, man. There is so much more room in a 5-inch rig. When we scale down to 3-inch, it is a real bitch to have it be light, durable, and to just package everything in there. It's a real bitch to package. And you know what really sucks is the moving to the AIO boards doesn't really benefit this style of frame nearly as much as like a toothpick style frame. Because if you want your camera to be inside the carbon and inside the standoff so it's fully protected, immediately you need minimum 20 millimeter standoffs. When you go to HD, you need 25 or even 28 millimeter standoffs. So you immediately have this vertical area that an AIO board doesn't help you out with. It actually kind of hurts a little bit, right? Because the AIO boards are wider. So now you got to make the base plate wider to accommodate the AIO board. And now that's adding weight. So 20 by 20 stacks, and maybe eventually 16 by 16 stacks are a much better fit for an alien style design where you want to protect your camera. And the camera protection, that's really where my need for a heavier frame came from. Just wanting to get the camera internal inside of the carbon, inside of the standoffs was like sort of a design requirement or whatever. KD, Larry, can inverting the motors help with getting rid of the props in view? Absolutely. But then your motors get hit even harder. A lot of our crashes are belly down. You know, usually we can get it gathered up to some extent and at least land right side up. And if you've got the motors on the bottom, when you land right side up, they're going to take a hell of a beating. The Alien design frame, right? Like what we're used to seeing in 5-inch rigs, that has been tested. And it keeps rising to the top as like the design. You know, people make subtle changes and really interesting changes, right? You know, Tommy put the arms on the top plate, which was super cool, but like it just keeps coming back to the OG Alien design, and most of the, you know, best frames available tend to be of that design. It's not the best. It strikes me that design is the best mix of everything. The best mix of flight characteristics, protection. I think you guys know what I'm talking about. It's not, it's maybe not like the best at any one thing, but it's the best at all of the things put together, right? There's no like glaring problem with it. It's just kind of like, an 8 out of 10 for everything, rather than being a 10 out of 10 in being a box frame and being triangulated. So yeah, that seems to be why it's the frame design that we all keep going to. Mondo says, chill and relax a bit. No chance. No relaxing. I relaxed last night, and now I push and smash. I'm gonna relax tonight, but first we stream. First we work. We're here to work, God damn it. Alex Neverede, I missed a bunch of comments. Alex says, love a stretched X frame. I'd love a stretched X frame along with the squished X. I don't know. I don't know if we'll do a stretched X. I want to do a true X for sure. For sure, I want to have a true X available for the people that don't care about props and view, and just want that feel. That true X feel. Stretched X, I don't know. Maybe. We'll see. If you guys bug me, and here's the thing, right? If you guys bug me enough for it, if enough people are like, dude, I need a top plate, I need your frame with a top plate that allows me more up tilt, and I need stretched X. If 20 of you guys say that you want that, I'll do it. What the hell? Because one of the things that I've been kind of keeping secret, but I mean, we're pretty deep into this pretty random stream, so it's more than likely the regulars that are here, and I love sharing the secrets with you guys. One of the things that I really want to do that I cannot fucking believe nobody's done is offer a whole bunch of arms, right? Standard squished X front arms, true X front arms, dead cat front arms, true X rear arms, squished at right, like when you cut frames, they cut it in a huge sheet of carbon, and arms, you can fit a million arms onto those sheets of carbon. Why hasn't anybody designed 4 or 5 different arm variety? Oh, and then lengths, right? 2-inch arms, 2.5-inch arms, 3-inch arms. Been talking to Stan FPV about his guards, and he gave me a specific number of the length that an arm is going to need to be for his ducts with a 3-inch prop. So there'll be a length arm for that. I'll have to be a little bit careful. But basically, the different like dead cat, stretch, true, those will all be around 3-inch. Th those will be to clear 3-inch props, and then for 2-inch it'll just be squished X. For 2.5-inch it'll just be squished X. But yeah, I'm why, right? Like what the my whole thought process is. That the canopy, this center canopy area, this really doesn't, it shouldn't need to change, right? Like, I don't care if it's a 2-inch prop or a 3-inch prop or a 2.5-inch prop. You got to put a camera, you got to put a stack, and you got to put a VTX and a receiver. And this is, I love this layout of clearing those things. So then why not? Like, what? If you want to build a dead cat setup, you should be able to. You shouldn't have to like buy some wacky ass frame because dead cat is not the norm. Some weirdo frame that's not durable, or it's got this part inverted for some strange reason, because I don't know, frame designers seem to tend, especially with micros, the design brief tends to go towards like make it wacky and weird for people to buy rather than making it durable and just like normal. So yeah, I don't know. I'm gonna try to change that a little bit and put the focus back on performance rather than just marketing and having something that looks cool. Because that's what means a lot to me, and I think there's a big hole in the microframe world for that. And I'm gonna fill the hole, guys. I'm gonna fill that fucking hole. I just got somebody in trouble for sure. Roscoe6 says you need to check out the Big Les show. It's right off also the Mike Nolan show, which is intertwined with the Big Les show. Absolutely insane. I'm down. I'll try anything once. Steve Rossi retracted a message. I'm, of course, curious what it was. Budget FPV says, you should talk to Steele about growing your sub count. He talked about it on the interview, he did, and talk about how one skateboarder he was following grew his sub count by 100,000 in 3 to 6 days. Jesus. Yeah, I've been, so I was actually talking to Steele today. He did a little live stream on Instagram, and, forgot that he had to pick something up from the Best Buy that's here in Alpharetta by me. So I actually called him and buzzed out to see if they would let me pick up the thing for him because he was too far away. And yeah, I'm very sensitive to like kind of using people, and I never, ever, ever want it to come off like that. If somebody wants to do something for that, like that for me, I need for it to be their decision. I need for them to come to me, just because there's baggage that can come along with stuff like that, right? Like, and it's just not my thing. I'm just not the type of person that, is gonna like volunteer someone else to do something for me. But that being said, I do try to put myself in a position where if somebody wanted to do something like that for me, that they could, and I'm going to say yes to it. That's kind of the other thing. It's very easy to kind of be too full of pride and to just like, no, I'm fine. And I spent a lot of my life doing that. I spent a lot of my life saying no to a lot of things because I got it. I'm good. I can handle this shit. Right. And what I realized pretty recently is like, if somebody wants to do something for you, let them, right? Like, when I want to do something for someone else and they say no, I'm like, I'm let down, you know? Like, I wanted to do that thing for them, and I thought it was valuable, and I thought, like, I was being nice by offering it to them. And yeah, like, when they say no, it's kind of like, oh, all right. I get it. Like, it's cool. Like, I'm never truly offended, but there was always like, oh, I was kind of looking forward to helping that person out. So yeah, if something like that did happen, I would say yes to it because I'm saying yes to as many things as I can nowadays. I don't want it to be weird at all. I value the friendship that him and I have. We're not like best friends or anything like that. We don't talk every week, but when we do talk, there's no preconceived, like, I feel like a lot of people hit him with stuff like that. I feel like a lot of people hit him up and like, yo, help me out. Yo, do this for me. And I just never want to be that person. And I think that if you are that person, it's just not going to work. Like, maybe that person will do the thing that you want them to do that one time, but they're not going to in the future. They're not going to like reach out to you. I don't know. It's such a slippery slope. And yeah, if somebody wants to help me, awesome. Love it. Absolutely love it. But I'm just not going to force it. I'm not going to make it unnatural. I would so much rather it be like a natural thing that just kind of happens, and maybe like we work together on something. Or one thing that I've been meaning to mention this to him, to see if he's interested. I don't know if he's probably done this before, but I think it would be cool for like me and him to fly. We're thinking about flying tomorrow. He's going to be up in the area tomorrow, so we're probably going to go out and fly. And I think it would be cool to have like two people fly the exact same spot and either like cut back and forth with the edit, or like do some kind of split screen, or like, I think it's so interesting the different flying styles that everyone has. And I think that Steele and I are fairly opposite, whereas like I try to be overly smooth and overly like slow and Yeah, I have a hard time describing my style, but and then steel is very quick and fast and skateboardy and like ripper-ish, whereas I'm more like going for like the more cinematic kind of. I'm trying to mix cinematic with freestyle, whereas I think steel is like the perfect example of what freestyle FPV is. So yeah, I think it would be cool to do like a little kind of project together, and that's the kind of thing that would get me a ton of exposure in like a natural kind of way. But you know, I'm always gonna be like, hey, any interest in this if you haven't done it before, if you've already done it and you like totally cool, totally get it. I don't know. I'm over explaining now. Let's move on. All right. Cool Coyote says, choose between the session 4 for $60, session 5 for 120, session 5 all day. The quality improvement of the session 5 over the session 4 is real. And I'm assuming because you said 120 bucks that you're looking for them on eBay. And on eBay, you can find them with the square trade protection. Make sure that you only do the $15 protection. The $10 protection will not help you. So at 120 bucks with the $15 protection, you're good. You break it, you 15 bucks to get your money back, and you roll it right in, right? Like that's the important thing to realize with sessions and GoPros in general, is you still want to figure out a way to get that warranty. Without the warranty, you're probably better off getting like the Runcam Box 5 or whatever the hell it is. There's some other options if you're not going to do the warranty. So yeah, session 5 for sure, all day. There's a big improvement that happened between the 4 and the 5. You can really see the difference. Okay. What else? I don't know why I'm so tired. Jesus. Okay. Also, I don't know why. Nobby says also, I don't know why, but the footage looks grainy sometimes after color correction. Almost at 400 subs finally. Congrats on that. Basically, if you push the color correction too far, it will try too hard to it'll try too hard to pull brightness out of the shadows. So here's the long and short of it. Don't go too aggressive on the color correction, specifically with your black point and with your shadows. I mean, across the board, you don't want to go too hard on color correction because it just starts to look unnatural. So yeah, whenever you're doing your final work to bring the levels up and to make it look good, always just try to be as subtle as possible. Try to push those sliders as little as possible to get it to the point where it looks good. Don't ever just go ham and max a slider out. You can almost never max a slider without it looking like shit in some way or another. It might not look like shit immediately, but once you start adjusting the other sliders, it'll start to look like ass and you won't know why. And it's because of that one that you just pushed too far. It's pretty rare that you can hammer, and this goes for like Lightroom, Photoshop, Premiere, DaVinci Resolve, any editing software. It's pretty rare that you can hammer a slider all the way to 100 or all the way down to negative 100 or zero, or whatever the hell the bottom is or the top is, and have it look good. It's usually gonna suffer. Love the Stretch X frame along with Squished X, says Alex. John Dyson says, in frame design, will 3-inch up. Okay, we talked about that. Okay. Oh, that's interesting. Tiago says the box frame is a pain to repair. So I can speak to that from the Hyperlow Vert V2. That's got like a lot of the triangulation going on, and to take it apart, it's a pain in the ass. There's just more screws. There's more things going on. There's more stuff in the way. So that's true. Yeah, box frame. I can totally see that being a lot harder to repair than a regular old, you know, standard open arm, I guess we could call it, frame. Larry says converting. Okay, we talked about that. Killer B, I can send you pics of how I have my builds on the Alien Mini Falco X Micro Alien if you want to host the images. I actually have images of both the Micro Alien and the Micro Reaver, but thanks for that, man. Good thought. For you, FPV, what's up, brother? S Grace, do you think buying LUTs are worth it? Absolutely not. There are lots and lots and lots of free LUTs, and I actually don't suggest using LUTs. All a LUT is a pre-cooked set of color correction parameters. For me, all I ever use those for, so they're called LUTs on Premiere. They're called scenes in Lightroom, I want to say, presets in Photoshop. They're all the same thing. LUTs is just a fancy word for a pre-cooked set of brightness, contrast, saturation, shadows, highlights, clarity, and some of these words even are different between DaVinci Resolve and Premiere, but it's just a pre-cooked set of adjustments done to the image. So for me, with a photography background and like 15 years in photo editing, it really doesn't make any sense. I can do all that individually myself and not sacrifice. So here's what you want to understand with a LUT, right? It's a shotgun instead of a scalpel. So typically somebody created that for a piece of film that they had, and then they maybe made it a little bit more open-ended. So there's no telling whether or not that's actually going to work properly for your specific footage, and it's probably not gonna. And then you're going to have to make adjustments anyway, and then why didn't you just do it from scratch from the beginning? One thing I will say about LUTs and presets and scenes is that they're good to kind of get the creative juices flowing sometimes, so they have their place. For sure they have their place. But I just do that by like going crazy with the sliders. Like if I'm just in there making adjustments, I'll grab the temperature slider and rail it all the way up to full warm and just see what it looks like. And hey, I just basically did what a LUT's going to do. So yeah, I mean, for me, I have them, I have the presets, I have the LUTs, I get them for free. I use them for inspiration, and then I make the adjustments the way that they should be for the specific piece of film, flying, whatever it may be. So yeah, sure, it's not for irony. It was just what was there. It is kind of funny that it says staff, but yeah, this is my my Rampage shirt from when I volunteered for those guys, for that event rather. So it just occurred to me that my throat's starting to hurt, which means my voice is starting to go, and if I'm gonna stream every day, I can't wreck my voice on the first day. So I'm gonna blast to the end of the comments. We're gonna put the other two motors on this thing. Maybe not. Maybe I'll just end it. Let me see where Kristen's at with work. And 104 people. Really? Damn. Clickbait works, bro. I gotta get fired more often. well, shit. If there's 104 of you in here, yeah, let's go. Let's keep going. Let's put two more motors on this guy. I got something cool to show you guys too. Ben, hold on. Nah, you won't care, Ben. You're not deep enough into this hobby to care about soldering irons. My mom got me a birthday present, and it's a Weller 1010, motherfuckers. So I'm gonna have two new soldering irons when the fire drone order gets here. Yeah, let me show you guys my new toy. I think I'm actually caught up on the chat. Ask Grace. So for the record, for anybody, I don't mean to discredit Johnny FPV's LUTs. I'm sure they're great. They certainly look great. But just understand what they are. Okay. Like those are premium. They're really charging premium for those. And that's fine. People's time is worth it, right? Like Johnny's time is worth more than mine. Okay. He gets paid more an hour than I do. And that's important. It's important to kind of keep that in mind. And he's working with some really amazing video editors now. So the quality of what he's selling is for sure way higher than the free ones that you're going to get. Yeah. Let's do it. Chat's going to be a little bit more difficult because I'm going to move over. Don't have the second monitor, blah, 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 blah. At CIDFPV, we'll light the chat up in orange and I will hopefully see it. Let's switch to the bench cam, which that should have done. Hey, look at that. And let me move some of these lights around. so that you guys can see what I'm doing. But first, and most importantly, how the hell am I going to show this to you guys? I don't think the cord's going to reach. Let me take this off. And, ooh, look at that, people. Look how professional that shit is. Look at that. It's got a digital readout. Yeah, buddies, there it goes. Heating up. So it's got, like, automatic shutoff, and the cable is nice and thin. Oh my god, I love this thinner cable for the actual iron. And look at this, man. Look at this nice little station. It's all coiled now. Look at that. It comes with the little chisel tip that I like. Nice and lightweight. It's all light blue and Weller-ish. Ooh. So my old soldering iron, I always suspected this. It was not thermostat based. It was just a dial that would control the amount of power. So when you would put the tip down on the work and it would start transferring heat into the work, the iron wouldn't do anything. It would just sit there and keep pushing the same amount of voltage, amperage, whatever the fuck it's doing, into the tip of the soldering iron. Whereas this one is thermostat controlled. So there's a thermocouple in the tip of the iron. So as soon as I put the tip of the iron down and the temperature drops on the tip of the iron, it sees that and it starts pushing harder on the iron to keep the temperature the same. And holy shit, does that make a difference. I am staggered at the difference that makes. TS100 heats up faster when it's on 6S. But this is not on 6S. This is pulling out of the wall, so it can't get that same voltage. I don't care. This heats up way faster than the previous one I was using, and it holds its temperature. So, yeah, this thing is absolutely amazing. I'm already so blown away, and I only used it for 20-30 minutes last night. Roscoe Sticks, how's your Lego going? It's going awesome. She's got she's making a dispensary right now and a supermarket, and it's just so cool, man. She's doing such cool stuff. Kristen loves Lego on Instagram if you guys want to see what she's up to. K-R-I-S-T... Oh, I'll type it into the chat. K-R-I-S-T-I-N loves Lego. There you guys go. Go friend her on Instagram. You will not be sad about it because she's doing good stuff. And she takes really good pictures, and it just looks super dope. So here's where we're at. This is what I did last night. I put these two on. Yes, I'm putting LED race wire on. No, I haven't lost my mind. I like them. I like race wire. What can I say? So let's keep going. This is actually a pretty challenging solder job. The pads on these tiny little race wires are just hilariously small. And these RC and power motors have 28 gauge wire, which is kind of cool, but it means that there's a lot of wire to try to tack down to that pad. And yeah, it's just kind of challenging, but luckily this new soldering iron is amazing, which has made it a lot easier. The chisel tip on it is a lot smaller than my previous iron, which is awesome, and it holds its temperature about 1,000 times better. So super, super, super impressive. I'm, yeah, $100 for this Weller is a hell of a deal. I am a fan. I'm a fan, guys. So one of the challenges here is getting the work, into a place where it's not going to move around. And I've been able to do a pretty good job with that with this guy here. So like this is the problem when you leave the rig all put together, is like the rig doesn't sit flat, and like these, I tried to cut these nice and short so they don't really want to reach to the, I guess they kind of reach to the mat, but it's been helpful to bring this in like this so that I can put the, to bring this piece of wood in like this so I can put the little race wire up on a surface, and then I can hold the wires in a way that's a little bit more accurate to get onto these pads. So first things first, let's tin this tiny little race wire, and yeah, we'll just get going. Hey, Yeah, pile of carbon. The 1010 is the one that somebody mentioned to me a couple weeks ago, and I added it to my Amazon wish list, and then both of my parents just went onto my wish list and just ordered me like the top 4, 5, or 6 things, which is so perfect because I try to keep that Amazon wish list updated, and I try to keep like the things that I really want on the top. So it was like amazing that they did that, because they just got me a whole bunch of stuff that I'm really sort of in need of. Oh, the other thing that this soldering iron has is auto shutdown or auto like cool down, and it's cool. It looks for the temperature of the tip to change. So basically what happens is you put the tip of the iron into your sponge, which cools it down. It sees that that temperature drop. I'm sure the TS100 does all these same things, but it's all new to me. So it sees that temperature drop, and then it resets its little auto shutoff timer, which is really good because the first I hooked it up yesterday, and I left it on overnight. But it didn't matter because after, like, it comes with that auto whatever setup. So yeah, it just spent all night on standby. So it maybe saved its own life, which was great. Yeah, the tip of the soldering iron wasn't even like oxidized or anything today when I looked at it. And I was like, okay, great. Good soldering iron, save bad users. Check. Got it. Okay, so we are putting this side in. So let's get these wires flattened out and drop down on these wee little pads. Alright. Athic says it took him a lot of practice to de-pin the AIO boards. Yeah, man, that is a bitch to do. I can show you a trick, though. A trick that I learned from Tommy recently that came in really handy when I was de-pinning this board, actually. So when you're de-pinning this board, and you've got these little tiny plug headers that are on the bottom of the board, and then you got to try to heat the top of the board up. The problem is, how the hell do I pull this off? Get you a pair of these spring-loaded tweezers, link affiliate link down below, of course, and clip it to the thing that you want to de-pin, and then you let it hang. And that provides you with the weight to pull that fucking thing off. So what I found I had to do is tilt the board a little bit to like wiggle this. And it worked so well. It would just wiggle and it would just pull itself out. So I was just sitting up on the top of the board, putting heat on the top of the through holes. And then I would just wiggle it a little bit. And then this guy would just, and then it would fall down and it would pull the, and it would take the little pin header with it. So if that's the problem that you've been having, which is the problem that I have depinning, is how do I have a third hand to be able to pull up on the little pin headers? There's a solution. Next time you have to do it, you'll forget, but then maybe the time after that you'll remember if you're anything like me. All right, let's get going here. Let me give you guys some zoomage so you can see what's going on. Somebody do me a favor and grab this time code and drop it into the comments so that. And put a little description of so yeah, I'm looking for your guys' help on the time codes. It's really hard to watch the full 17 hours streams that I do, and yeah, that's me license. Yeah, if you guys help me out a little bit with time codes, and like when something cool happens in the episode, just grab the time code, drop it down in a comment, and be like, you know, this is when Ciotti blew his nose and a booger came flying out and he didn't see it on his shirt for the next 20 minutes. Yeah, do that. That would be awesome. And I put a post up on Patreon about it too. Yeah, that's fine. Okay. There we go. There's some zoomage. License to drive says, hang on, father soldered for NASA and you only just now... got a soldering iron with a thermocouple in it. Fuck you. Well, I hung on to the old iron for so long because one of the reasons is because he bought it for me. So I felt bad, like, thanks for the gift, Dad. It sucks. I don't want it anymore. It is actually a great soldering iron. He got it for me long, long, long ago before there was any inkling that I would be actually soldering. So yeah, he got me a good iron for what it was, but nowadays it was time. It was time to upgrade. And yeah, my father worked for the Princeton Plasma Physics Lab. They ran a tokamak fusion reactor to see if fusion could be the future of energy. But then in the 90s, one of the Bushes cut a lot of the experimental energy funding, experimental power production funding, and the lab got cut down quite a bit. And then he started working for the college that I graduated from, which was super cool because he was there while I was going, so I could visit him every so often. And yeah, and now he's retired. All right, got this third one on here, and then we will check for bridges because this shit is so small that I actually can't see with the naked eye whether or not I've bridged these guys. So I got to do it with a 5X loop, which we should be all doing anyway, right? You guys are doing all the right things with your soldering. You should be practicing all the fundamentals, I hope. If you're not, I get it. Sometimes you just got to get it done quick. I know how it is. But those of you that are new or not super confident in your soldering abilities, one of the tricks is to just stick to the basics. Always flux, always tin, always get a little bit of fresh solder on the tip of the iron, which I'm not doing right now, and is one of the reasons I'm struggling. There we go. I just wanted to get that turned a little bit, and it came completely off, of course. All right, give that a second. All right, that should be good. Let's see how it looks. Be right back. And yeah, not gonna win any contests, but not bridged. Yeah, totally fine. That'll do, donkey. That'll do. Give him a little pull. Make sure they're strong. Good to go. We're gonna do the other one, and then we're gonna do the motors. Message above this: just plug it in. Done. I actually did plug it in last night. It didn't blow up, so no more blowing up flight controllers on the channel for me until the next build. I think I missed a couple comments. Oh no, it looks like I'm good. Pilot Carbon says, might be the one I linked then. Really happy it was a hit. Yeah, hell yeah, man. Thanks for that. Thanks for the link, Pyle. Much appreciated. Here we go. All right, see you later, Yannick. Be good, man. Thanks for hanging. I'm not... parts, no, I'm not wearing those funny glasses. You'll never see those again. They just hurt my nose so bad. And my eyes were a little bit tired Monday night as well. 9:08 p.m. All right, let's go. Let's go and get this done because I haven't had... Well, I guess I did have dinner. I did have dinner, but I want to spend some time with my beautiful wife tonight. So, sorry guys, but she's way hotter than all of you. Okay. Get this separated here, and all right, looks good. And we're going LED towards the inside. Let's get it going. Got a little piece of solder going here because I'm gonna tin the tip this time. I will stop being so lazy. I'm not gonna flux though, that's just too much work. The solder has enough flux in it for me. We'll be okay. All right, there we go. And let's do the thing. Another little tip is to grab these wires right at the end of the tweezers. This way you can put the wire nice and flat against the pad. You don't have like the tweezer getting in the way of the bottom of the of getting the wire low enough. So there's that. That's always a good practice. Hey, don't do that, you jerk. There we go. All right. And grab it by there. Yeah, see, this is where it starts to get woolly once it's connected to one. And these race wires are so lightweight that like they'll actually sit up in the air as well. There's all kinds of weird little issues I've been dealing with that don't happen on the other race wires. But just one more thing to troubleshoot, man. It can be done. Just gotta be on your game. Alright. Let's get this going here. And come on, you jerk. I'm trying to use the wires like sort of memory to hold it in place. There we go, that's better. And I got a little bit too much solder on the tip of this. Let's see if I can go in dry and get it done. These pads are actually close enough together where if you have the tip tinned with too much solder, it'll bridge. And the threshold for that is very low with this. Like if you just have a little bit too much, it's no good. I think this might be bridged, but I'm just gonna throw this third one on here just in case it's not, and then I'll take a look with the loop. Stop it, you jerk! Stop doing that! Stay on there. Stay in one place. Oh man, I made a mess out of this. I pushed too hard on the wire and then it fanned out. Well, I mean, it is on there. Let me see how bad it is. It's going to be pretty bad, I can tell. Which one's which? Which one did I just do? This one? Well, I mean, it can't be that bad. Huh. It's not bad at all. This one on the other side is pretty bad, though. I'm going to fix this one. Those were fine, though. Weird. They looked really bad. That was strange. All right. I've also had the itchiest nose in the world today. In talk therapy, I could not... I swear to God, I was like, is she going to think I'm a cokehead? I mean, she knows that I'm not, but... There we go. And it went into... So it did go into standby mode. I have to change the timer. It's going... Oh, you know what? I could just do it right now. Push the button. And let's go up to 10 minutes on the timer. There we go. Look at that. Yeah, the timer was set to like 2 minutes. Okay. For the auto standby, that is. Let's get this one fixed, and then we will get them motors out. Whoop. Yeah. Let's chop that off with the clippers. All right, so we're good. These are not... None of these joints are all that pretty, but they don't have any problems. They're not going to be weak. They don't have any big holes in them. They're just not as pretty. And when you're working on this small scale, it is a lot harder to get them to be pretty. So I'm just, yeah, it's fine. It's fine. Everything's going to be fine. Larry's asking a good email address. Here you go, Larry. This is for anybody too. Anybody that wants to stuck in trees. The Funtac I have, I hate it because it melts and it gets all sticky and horrible. So I tend to not use it. If I'm not being lazy, I'll use masking tape. That's my favorite to hold stuff in place. But I'm just trying to fly through this so that I can go and relax. So forgive the shoddy soldering, but These are strong joints. They're just not pretty joints. And with how many builds I need to get done, yeah, I'm just going for strong. I can't really. Every once in a while, I'll put the extra time in to get the joints to be really pretty. But I'm going more towards just ugly joints that are strong recently. So, let's see where I can put this. So, what I'm trying to do now at this point is keep as much wire on this as I can, just in case I need to move this to a different frame or something weird like that. But at the same time, I want to get this back on the arm as far as I can so that I can leave as much wire on the motor as possible. And I'm not trying, like, I'm not saying like tons, but yeah, I do want to leave, I do try to leave more than is needed, just to kind of bail myself out in the future. So just kind of line that up and just left a little mark in the wire, and then I'll line all three of them up and chop them. And now on these tiny little wires, I really recommend not using cutters to strip these. Just use your fingernails. And even if you barely have fingernails like me, you can still make it work. And when you're doing this with your fingernails, really dig in there. Like, really dig to make sure that you leave a deep enough indent with your fingernails to make sure you push through this shielding. If you don't push hard enough with your fingernails, and then you pull, you can yank the whole wire out of the motor. So, like, when you pinch it, really, like, pinch it hard, and then yank it off, and, yeah, you won't ruin the motor by yanking one of the wires straight off of the stator, which I've definitely not done more than once. That's definitely never happened to me on multiple occasions. It helps if you do that with your voice, too. Just give a little. All right, let's tin these little fellers. Not going to zoom for this because tinning is just not that interesting. There we go. There we go. And there we go. So, yeah, let's just tack this one on. I was going to do the other one, but we'll do them one by one. That's fine. All right. Now we're going to move the work around a little bit because we always want to move the work to us, right? So we're going to move this around a little bit. You know what I'm going to do? I'm going to stick that down. I'm going to grab some VHB. Oh, and I'm also going to remember to put the goddamn shrink wrap on. Huzzah! I was pretty sure I was going to forget it, and I almost forgot it. Actually, let me do the VHB first. Little tiny strip of VHB on there. And then we shall... I don't know. You make it up from there. How long has this stream been going? Any of you guys know? I forget what time I went on. Was it 7? Was it 6? Was it 5? Was it 4? Was it 3? Was it 2? Was it 1? Definitely wasn't 1. Oh my god, come on. This is the worst part of building right here. Getting the backing off of the VHB. Hands down. This is it. This is the worst part. No, these are 1.5 mil shafts, which, well, I hope they are. I hope they're 1.5. I didn't actually test them. I'm pretty sure these are the 1.5 mil shafts, though, because they look normal to me. That extra 0.5 millimeter would look very strange to me because I've been using 1.5 mil shaft motors for, like, 3+ years. Alright. Get this stuck down there. You always want to do something on the bottom of these to make sure that you're insulating them. The shrink wrap would work, but I'm actually shrink wrapping these down to the arm. So that wouldn't work, right? Because that would pull the bottom of this PCB into the carbon. And you just need to be careful with that because the because carbon is conductive. So keep that in mind. Let's make sure that that's where it needs to be. And it most certainly is. All right, good. So shrink wrap on. Push it as far back as possible so that it doesn't get hot from the soldering iron transferring heat. And I'll do the first one by holding the motor as I usually do. All right, nice and clean soldering tip. Let's see if we can go in dry and get this done. Should be good. Yeah, we're all set. It's another thing that this iron is way better with. Like, I can be even sloppier with this iron, which is really nice, because that being sloppy, not sloppy, sloppy's the wrong word, but you guys know what I mean. Like, you got to cut corners to save time. You can't do it perfectly every time, and rip through a build quick. And for me, it's a matter of, like, cutting corners. I can do a build in a sane amount of time. Doing a build perfectly really takes time for me. All right, there's that one. And so the outside ones with tiny little race pads, race wires like these, the outside ones, you want to cheat them a little bit. You want to go even wider with them, like put them on the very outside of the pad. And because you need every, like, fraction of a millimeter. Let's see how that looks. And it's beautiful, Clark. It's a beaut. All right. Looks good. Let's make sure it's strong. One, two, three. Good to go. Now the satisfying part. First, though, put the screws in to make sure that we're not going to shrink wrap it down to the wrong spot. So get the motor bolted up. And I'm also going to have to push. Some of these windings are like hanging down, and you can push them up a little bit in these motors to get them away from the screws coming through. And you got to be careful when you do this, because the windings are not super strong. So just be careful. But totally doable. I know I'm doing this off camera, but I'm just literally pushing up on the windings just to clear a little bit more of a gap for the hardware to come through. All right, so that's done. Now let's get two pieces of hardware so that this motor will sit in the correct spot, and then we'll throw that shrink wrap on and drop some screws. All right, so the two outside ones are on. This way the motor is rotated and clocked properly, and it is. See, so that's just, I just wanted to make sure there wasn't too much slack. This thing is VHP'd down in the right spot. So now we can play with fire. Here comes the satisfying bit. Are you guys ready? Here it comes. Oh, the ceiling fan is on. Yeah, I'll push through. See if I can get it. Oh, yes. Oh, it's so terrific. Look at that, guys. Come on. Come on now. Tell me that's not worth the effort to get something that looks that good. Tell me. Tell me. Tell me. Come on, tell me. For real. Tell me. No, don't tell me. I don't want to know. If it's not worth the effort, I definitely don't want to know, because I'm definitely going to do it one more time. all right, get this off of here. 2 hours and 20 minutes, not bad. Skip the VHB, surprisingly heavy. That's why I use tiny little bits of it. I use like the least amount of VHB possible for that exact reason. I'm glad somebody else is as crazy as I am about weight. Just the fact that somebody else knows that about VHB. The other thing that's really heavy, you got to be careful with, is shrink wrap. Again, It's why I'm using little tiny pieces of shrink wrap just to cover this guy up. But yeah, shrink wrap is rubber, dude. Rubber's heavy. Be careful with that shrink wrap. It can add up. Yeah, typically I use zip ties on the arms because it tends to be lighter than shrink wrap. Although the main reason is that it's just a lot easier to work with. It's such a bastard to cut the shrink wrap off in the field if you need to get it off of an arm. Come on, man. Don't fight me, penis. Just on tonight's stream, we'll be struggling with VHB again. Great. Yeah, fall on the table so that you get nice and dirty and don't have any stickiness left. Oh, hey, I got the corner. Come on, come on, come on. Come on. No. No. Oh, there we go. There we go. Okay. Let's see if I can get a fingernail in here. Ugh. Okay. Little hippie to the hoppy. Heap, heap, hop. There we go. All right. Let's fold these wires down in a pleasing way. And stick it. Why don't you stick it in your bum bum? Tom Green said. Anybody remember that movie? I fucking loved that movie. I was a big Tom Green fan. Everybody said I looked like him. Yeah, big fan. Big fan of that guy way back in the day. What would you love a link to? Who would love a link? Ask moderators for links. They can paste links. Or over on Discord, you guys can do links. License any lighter? What? Oh shit, you're right. He is Canadian. I always forget that about him. That's right. He's like the funniest Canadian ever, I guess, right? Nah, there's been plenty of funny Canadians. I can't think of any of them, but I know that there have been. Okay. That's a little bit better. All right, yeah, that's a good spot. So, get it right there. That's far enough back. And let's line the motor up, figure out how much motor wire we need. And this will actually be done. Other than spinning the right direction, but we'll do a little hover. Because what's life without a little recklessness? And how reckless can you possibly be with a toothpick, right? Just notch the wire so I know where. Line them up and choppy choppy. Find that little nick that I left in the wire. And there it is. Cut all three of them the same length. And away we go. So this is not a 28 gauge wire on this one. That's interesting. This one motor has thinner wires. I bet you this is straight from RC and Power. I know that Kebab specifically asks these motor manufacturers if they're going to sell their motors on a site that they need to use better wire. So this is maybe like a sample motor that they sent him before he told them that they needed to use better wire than this, which is fine. I will. So the other reason why I'm kind of half-assing some of these solder joints is this is a toothpick, and it's not going to be anywhere. The reliability is not going to mesh really well with the way that I fly. So I know that I'm going to be replacing these motors. Luckily, I have eight of these motors. I was going to do a giveaway with four of them, but realistically, I need all eight of these. So I got a bunch of other motors in that box from him that I will do giveaways with. Okay, so here's the other problem. I didn't really look at these motors, but they are 2 millimeter motor shafts. And what that means is, I'm not going to test hover this because I don't have any props with 2 millimeter motor shafts. So, fuck. All right, well, I have more of these motors, and I just need to find one with a 2 mil shaft, of which none of these are. So, Oh, wait, no, here, there's two more over here. Let's see. Let's see. Well, this is actually not the end of the world either because this is going to be I'm going to have two toothpicks, it's looking like. And this is going to be the heavier one with HD, and these are both 1.5 mil as well. Okay, terrific. So, see you guys later. Goodbye! Come on, man, really? I just happened to pick the four motors with 2 mil shafts. Are you kidding me? So I got like 10 of these motors, and I somehow managed to solder up the three of them that have 2 millimeter shafts first. Oh my God, Well, God damn it. Why does this have to happen? Why? I want someone to explain it to me right now, or there will be bloodshed. Okay, I'm gonna stop there because I have to order more of these motors with the 2 mil shaft. Oh my God. Is this real life? Is this really happening right now? Is there really not a single other one of these? No, there's not. I know that there's not. I don't know why I'm bothering to look around. I know it. That's where the name Whoop comes from. All right, well, then there's that. Okay, goodbye. Bye. Yeah, I mean, I don't have propellers. I don't have a fourth motor. You son of a bitches. License to drive says Ciotti got shafted. Indeed. Well, this is a good spot to stop anyway. I'm yawning more and more. Wait, no. Okay, enough of this. I'm out of here. I'm gonna go get some food. I'm gonna go relax, and I'll see you guys tomorrow. How about that? I haven't been able to say that on any day other than Sunday. Wait, yeah, let me. Chat stuff. Mike Myers is Canadian. Nice. Tiago had the same issues with VHP this morning. S Grace. Tom was on Rogan. No way. And he's still hilarious. Nice. I'll check that out. I love Joe Rogan's podcast. My God. Nobby retracted a message, and that's it. That's what we need to leave. I'll see you guys tomorrow for real. And yeah, thanks for everything, guys. Very, very cool of every single one of you. And that's all I got. Later. See you guys tomorrow. Who knows what we'll do?